Cartoon bands as a concept had existed before Gorillaz. While the Archies, Josie and the Pussycats, and Alvin and the Chipmunks had toyed with the medium, Gorillaz was the first time where it was more than just a novelty. For the past two decades, they had been pumping out weird and wonderful pop music, spanning multiple genres, and featuring far-reaching musical guests. Who would have thought that the guy from Blur would work with Bobby Womack, Neneh Cherry, Noel Gallagher, and half of The Clash? But beyond that, the group has defied all expectations and become global superstars. As much as they are a cartoon band, the project has evolved way beyond that. But it had to start somewhere, with their first tentative steps. This is New British Canon, and this is the story of Clint Eastwood. The creation of Gorillaz all comes down to two men, Damon Albarn and Jamie Hewlett. Albarn had made himself known, in the UK at least, as the frontman of Britpop entity Blur. With the band's previous two albums, Blur and 13, they had tried to distance themselves musically from their Britpop roots, experimenting with American alt-rock, psychedelia, and electronica. Despite this, Albarn felt limited by the band dynamic, being one voice of four. Some soundtrack work had whetted his appetite for a solo career, but was unsure of a direction. On the other hand, Hewlett was the creator of the Tank Girl series of comics, and deemed to be one of the defining pop artists of the 1990s. But by 94, he'd grown tired of his creation, having been drawing her for 6 years. We were gonna kill the character off when MGM phoned up. We knew that if MGM got their hands on it, they'd fuck it up. But we didn't care because they offered us quite a lot of money. Enough to make me go, oh, okay. The resultant film, 1995's Tank Girl, starring Lori Petty and Ice-T, bombed financially and critically, was not well received. But what next? Albarn and Hewlett had originally met in 1990, Blur's guitarist Graham Coxon persuading Hewlett to interview the fledgling band for Deadline magazine, home of Tank Girl. Through the mid-90s London party scene, Hewlett and Albarn kept in touch. After breakups with their respective long-term girlfriends, the pair decided to move in together. After a few months of shameless celebrity-packed parties in their swanky new flats, they began to look forwards. We'd spent hours watching MTV and wondering why everything on it was so terrible. I think Damon was tired of being the frontman for Blur, and I was just aghast at how boring most pop groups were when they were interviewed. So we said, let's make up a fake band. Gorillaz originated with Murdoch Nicholls. Born in Stoke-on-Trent in 1966, his formative inspirations were the likes of Black Sabbath, The Clash, and Anton LaVey.
Heavy metal music and devil worshipping became my favourite pastimes. My brother Hannibal's tastes were more dub and punk based, but I soaked it all up. Actually, it was my love of The Clash that eventually opened up the world of dub reggae to me. But my first true love was always heavy metal. Lovely, thick, gooey black metal.
After making some negotiations with Beelzebub, he acquired Satan's Own bass guitar, fittingly named El Diablo. He spent his adolescence and early 20s fronting various groups, including Patchouli Clark, Crimson Backdraft, and Burning Sensations, with limited success. As much as he had musical vision and the Dark Lord's backing, he needed a face and voice more agreeable than his own to get through to the music-buying public. In August 1997, Nicholls' path collided with amateur keyboard geek Stuart Potts, quite literally. While attempting to acquire new musical equipment through non-financial means, Nicholls drove a Vauxhall Astra through Uncle Norm's organ emporium, straight into Potts, who happened to be working there at the time. The collision knocked Potts' left eye straight out of his head and left him in a vegetative state. Nicholls was sentenced to 30,000 hours of community service and 10 hours a week looking after the comatose Potts. During one of these fun-filled sessions, while Nicholls was doing donuts in a Nottingham car park, A jolt made Potts fly through the windscreen and hit the curb face first. This not only relieved him of his right eye, but also his catatonic state. As he rose to his feet, eyeless and half his face missing, Nichols knew he'd found his frontman. Potts would soon adopt the moniker of 2D, in honor of the two deep black dents in his face. Next was drummer Russell Hobbs. Formerly of Brooklyn, New York, he was sent to England by his parents for his own safety after a drive-by shooting by the Grim Reaper himself killed all his friends but spared him.
Immediately, that's when all these spirits, the ghosts of my dead departed friends, all entered my body. Like they was being sucked up, like sheets being sucked up into a vacuum cleaner. Bam, bam, whoosh, bam, straight into me.
The event turned his eyes a milky white and gave him the musical abilities of his dead friends. Hobbs was then kidnapped by Nichols and taken to Kong Studios in Essex. He stayed because of how good Nichols' demos were. Their guitarist Noodle, a Japanese 10-year-old, joined the group after being sent to Kong Studios in a FedEx crate.
We heard a knock at the studio door, and there's this big box there, and out jumped a small Japanese person carrying a Les Paul. I couldn't make out a word she was saying. It's just gibberish. But then she unleashed a massive guitar riff, what sounded like 200 demons screaming in Arabic. It was brilliant. She ended it with a 20-foot-high karate jump. She bowed and just said one word. Noodle.
With all their members in place, they set about writing music, their first creation being Ghost Train, formed from a sample of the Human League's The Sound of the Crowd. Their first gig was at the Camden Brown House in November 1998, and it ended in a riot. But despite having only one song, they were instantly signed by EMI for their Parlophone label. What they needed now was to write more songs and assemble them into an album. With the law in place, Gorillaz needed a sound. Albarn wasn't satisfied with doing Blur Mark II, and so for the most part abandoned guitar music. If he was trying to satirize the fake nature of pop bands like A1 and NSYNC, he would need to be making pop music, but with a twist. Bands like Big Audio Dynamite, The Specials, and Massive Attack were templates for what he wanted to do. Groups that created music unique to them, not tied down to a genre or scene. That's what I've always wanted to do, because I always wanted to be in The Specials, and then I wanted to be in Massive Attack. And that's just kind of what I've mixed, really. It's The Specials and Massive Attack together to make Gorillaz. Well, Ghost Train was indeed the first song Albarn wrote for the project, back when they were named Gorilla, singular. He'd been experimenting with that sound within Blur since 1997.
It's called On Your Own, but you know what, that's kind of like one of the first ever Gorillaz tunes, if you want to look at kind of how things sort of develop. I mean, that was definitely a moment where I thought, oh, I quite like doing it this way as well.
The album was written and recorded in bits and pieces from December 1998 through October 2000, initially starting in Albarn's London studio, before moving over to Jamaica's G-Jam Studios, to complement the reggae-tinged music that Albarn was creating. But the process wasn't all on Albarn. He invited Dan the Automator of Dr. Octagon and Primal Scream's Exterminator fame to produce. The musician guest list, something that later Gorillaz albums would double down on, features Tina Weymouth of The Talking Heads on 19-2000. Cuban singer Abraham Feria on Latin Simone. As well as Scratching from Kid Koala and Miho Hattori of Sibo Matto supplying the vocal for Noodle. As a result, the final product is an eclectic mix of hip-hop, trip-hop, dub and pop. But what it still needed was a blockbuster single. Instrumentally, Clint Eastwood is a very simple song. its reggae-inspired chords were played on a Selena string ensemble keyboard. This was augmented with a drum machine beat, and Albarn's favoured instrument at the time, the melodica. Inspired in part by dub legend Augustus Pablo's use of the instrument. The melody line that Albarn peppers within the song is what gave Clint Eastwood its name, due to its comparative similarity to Ennio Morricone's theme for The Good, the Bad and the Ugly. If I hadn't spent all those years learning how to play instruments, I'd be using a sampler to put all these pieces together. Instead, I use a songwriting method that's a lot like sampling, without actually digitally sampling. Gorillaz is how I take everything I hear and filter it. Initially, Thy Life Cypher rapped on the track. But Dan the Automator felt his verses could be improved on. Having worked with Del the Funky Homo Sapien on the Deltron 3030 album, Dan invited him to step it up and write something better. Finally, someone let me out of my cage. Now, time for me is nothing cause I'm counting no A's. Dan gave me very little information to work with. He told me the song came from the point of view of Russell, and there's a ghost living in his head of a dead friend, I believe, or something like that. So his spirit is still with him. So I'm like, okay, and what else? That's it? I'm supposed to write something with just that? He's like, just be creative. You have creative license to do what you think it's about from there. Corruption in the skies from this fucking enterprise. Now I'm sucked into your lies through rust, so not his muscles, but percussion to provide. Del would also feature on the single Rock the House. I know you like that, you wanna try that. It's like a flashback, so shake your ass crack. But the music video is what spun heads. Created by a team of about 25 led by Hewlett, the creepy cool video took just under 4 months to animate. What could have been a standard band performance video is thrown out the window because A, they are a cartoon band. B, Russell's departed friend Del the Ghost Rapper makes an appearance. And C, there are zombie gorillas. Zombies in pop music videos are not new. In fact, Michael Jackson's Thriller video is explicitly referenced. But Hewlett, in particular, had an affinity for the horror subgenre, watching various zombie flicks while animating. The opening of the video features an on-screen quote from 1978's Dawn of the Dead, in both Japanese and English. Every dead body that is not exterminated becomes one of them. It gets up and kills. The people it kills get up and kill. Zombies are always a metaphor. In Dawn of the Dead, they represent rampant consumerism. In Clint Eastwood, they stand in for the fake pop bands that Gorillaz were formed to defeat. The video was also the perfect way to introduce the band to the public. By the end, viewers knew each member's name, look, and personality. The anonymity of Gorillaz was a plus for Albarn. No longer having to be in the music video or be the center of attention that his Britpop years in Blur had thrust upon him. I don't think I was ever cut out to be a great frontman. I think it's something I enjoyed to a degree, but I think I was a bit too self-conscious. Clint Eastwood was released as a single on the 5th of March 2001. Its innovative video and ample airplay got the track to number 3 in the UK charts. A more high-tempo garage remix by Ed Case also helped the track get play with club DJs, and was the version that appeared on Now 48. I ain't happy, I'm feeling glad I got sunshine. In a bag I'm useless, but not for long, the future is coming on. Said NME of the remix. A little shift in perspective, and suddenly, you've got a West London basement Jacks, embodying a more interesting and accurate vision of England than anything Blur dared to attempt. The album went number 3 in the UK charts and climbed to number 14 in the US Billboard chart. Despite having 3 top 10 singles in the US Billboard Hot 100, Blur were never really embraced by the US. Gorillaz, on the other hand, were. And worldwide, Clint Eastwood became Damon Albarn's biggest hit, particularly resonating with Italy, Japan, and South America. It has since been praised by NME and Rolling Stone as one of the greatest songs of the 2000s. The song and Gorillaz' lasting impact can be seen on the next generation of alternative music. No longer merely guitar pop, artists like the 1975, Foster the People, AWOL Nation, and Paramore have taken Gorillaz' collision of rock, hip-hop, and electronica and run with it. From the hip-hop side of things, Tyler, the Creator, Brockhampton, Trippie Redd, and A$AP Rocky have all noted the influence of Gorillaz' first album. They also proved that a virtual band concept could work, resulting in Adult Swim's Death Clock, Hasune Miku, and even Poppy, pushing the boundaries of how you can deliver pop music in a postmodern context. Gorillaz showed that it could be more than a gimmick. The animated video was no doubt attractive to younger fans, aided by Gorillaz' award-winning web integration, and expanded that generation's sonic palette. No longer satisfied with the sweetest pop bubblegum, with Gorillaz, Albarn could expose them to concepts that did not get radio play. Latin folk, reggae, trip-hop, spaghetti westerns, and George Romero. Gorillaz would go on to bigger and better things, with starrier guest musicians. But Clint Eastwood was the start. The moment where an art rocker, a cartoonist, a Satanist, an eyeless crooner, a possessed drummer, and a 10-year-old joined forces, and somehow it made sense. The future was coming on. Thanks for watching. What's your favorite Gorillaz track? Comment down below. In a recent poll, this video just barely missed getting first place against Paper Planes. So far, I should get this out as soon as possible, which I have. You can help make these channel shifting decisions by being part of my Patreon family. So why not check that out? Big thanks to everyone who already supports me. This makes Trash Fury possible. So yeah, I'll see you in 2 weeks.